through the mysterious, eerie mist we go, wrapped in the chill of the utmost fear, on a chase of sounds and shadows, not knowing where to turn or who to follow, but getting closer still. Beware. You've reached. The edge of nightfall. The Waxwork by Burrage.
Once in a while in my reading, I come across a short story so different, so powerful, so well written, that I can't forget it. Our first story tonight is a case in point, written by one of England's masters of the short story art, Burrage. It's about a man who went out of his way to scare himself to the absolute limit. Listen while I tell you about The Waxwork. While the uniformed attendants of Merrimer's Waxworks were ushering the last stragglers through the great glass-paneled double doors, the manager sat in his office interviewing Raymond Hewson, a journalist. The manager was speaking.
Yes, Mr. Hewson. It used to be said years ago that Madame Tussauds would give a man £100 for sleeping alone in the Chamber of Horrors. I hope you don't think that we've made any such offer, Mr. Hewson. However, if you get your story printed in the Morning Echo, there will be a £5 note waiting for you here when you care to come and call for it.
Well, that's satisfactory.
Fine. But first of all, it's no small ordeal that you're proposing to undertake. I'd like to be quite sure about you, and I'd like you to be quite sure about yourself. I own I shouldn't care to take it on. I've seen those wax figures dressed and undressed, and I know all about the process of their manufacture. I can walk about in their company downstairs as unmoved as if I were walking among so many Skittles. But I should hate having to sleep down there among them, alone. Well, why? I don't know. There isn't any reason. I don't believe in ghosts. It's just that I couldn't sit alone among them at night with their seeming to stare at me the way they do. No, the whole atmosphere of the place is unpleasant. And if you are susceptible to atmosphere, I warn you that you are in for a very uncomfortable night.
Hewson had known that from the moment when the idea had first occurred to him. His soul sickened at the prospect, even while he smiled casually upon the manager. But he had a wife and family to keep, and for the past month, he had found almost no newspaper work. Here was a chance not to be missed. The price of a special story in the Morning Echo, with a £5 note to add to it. It meant comparative wealth and luxury for a week, and freedom from the worst anxieties for a fortnight. Besides, if he wrote the story well, it might lead to an offer of regular employment. So, he said to the manager, I've already promised myself an uncomfortable night because your murderer's den is obviously not fitted up as a hotel bedroom. But I don't think your waxworks will worry me much.
You're not superstitious?
Not a bit.
But you're a journalist. You must have a strong imagination.
Well, the news editors for whom I work have always complained that I haven't any.
Well, there is one condition I'm afraid I must impose upon you. I must ask you not to smoke. Yes, we had a fire scare down in the murderer's den earlier this evening. I don't know who gave the alarm, but it was a false one. Fortunately, there were very few people down there at the time, or there might have been a panic. And now, if you're ready, we'll go.
Well, Hewson followed the manager through half a dozen rooms where attendants were busy shrouding the wax figures. Beyond these rooms was the murderer's den. It was a room of irregular shape with a vaulted roof, by design an eerie and uncomfortable chamber whose atmosphere invited its visitors to speak in whispers. The waxwork murderers stood on low pedestals. The manager, walking around with Hewson, pointed out several of the more interesting of these unholy criminals, and Hewson pointed and whispered, "Who's that?"
"Oh? I was coming to him. Hey, come and have a good look at him. Oh, this is our star boarder, Dr. Boudin."
"Huh? Yes, I think I've heard the name, but I forget in connection with what."
"Well, you'd remember better if you were a Frenchman. For some long while, that man was the terror of Paris, yes. As he carried on his work of healing by day and throat cutting by night when the fit was on him. He killed for the sheer devilish pleasure it gave him to kill. And always in the same way, with a razor. After his last crime, he left a clue behind which set the police upon his track. One clue led to another, and before very long, they knew that they were on the track of the Parisian equivalent of our Jack the Ripper. But when he realized that the police were closing about him, he mysteriously disappeared. And ever since, the police of every civilized country have been looking for him."
"Hmm. Yes, well, I don't like him at all. Ooh, what eyes he's got."
"Yes. This wax figure's a little masterpiece. You find the eyes bite into you? Well, now, that's excellent realism, then. For Burdett practiced mesmerism and was supposed to mesmerize his victims before dispatching them."
"Huh. I thought I saw him move."
"Yes. You'll have more than one optical illusion before the night's out, I expect. You shan't be locked in. You can come upstairs when you've had enough of it." "Well, good night, Mr. Hewson."
"Good night. I'll see you in the morning." The manager left, and Hewson got ready for the night. He wheeled the armchair a little way down the central gangway and deliberately turned it so that its back was toward the effigy of Dr. Burdett. For some undefined reason, he liked Dr. Burdett a great deal less than his companions. Busying himself with arranging the chair, he was almost lighthearted. But when the attendant's footfalls had died away and a deep hush stole over the chamber, he realized that he had no slight ordeal before him. The dim, unwavering light fell on the rows of figures which were so uncannily like human beings that the silence and the stillness seemed unnatural and even ghastly. The eyes of Dr. Burdett's effigy haunted and tormented him, and he itched with a desire to turn and look. At last he could stand it no longer and quickly looked behind him. Among the many figures standing in the stiff, unnatural poses, the effigy of the dreadful little doctor stood out with a queer prominence. Hewson looked into the doctor's eyes for one agonized second and turned again to face the other direction. It struck him, in the moment or two while he'd looked behind him, that there had been the least subtle change in the grouping of the figures in front. Hewson held his breath for a moment and then drew his courage back to him as a man lifts a weight. He remembered the words of more than one news editor and laughed savagely to himself, saying, "Yes, and they tell me I've got no imagination." He thought this was very cowardly and very absurd. They were only waxworks, and they couldn't move. Let him hold that thought, and all would be well. But then, why all that silent unrest about him? A subtle something in the air which didn't quite break the silence and happened whichever way he looked, just beyond the boundaries of his vision. Suddenly, he heard somebody breathing. He swung around quickly to encounter the mild but baleful stare of Dr. Burdett. No change. Oh, this was a little too much. It was bad enough that the waxwork effigies of murderers should move when they weren't being watched, but it was intolerable that they should breathe. Somebody was breathing. Or was it his own breath, which sounded to him as if it came from a distance? He sat rigid, listening and straining, until he exhaled with a long sigh. His own breath, after all, or if not, something had divined that he was listening and had at that moment ceased breathing. Now, this would not do. This distinctly would not do. He must clutch at something, grip with his mind upon something which belonged essentially to the workaday world, to the daylight London streets. He was Raymond Hewson, an unsuccessful journalist, a living and breathing man, and these figures grouped around him were only dummies, so they could neither move nor whisper. still, the gaze of Dr. Burdett urged, challenged, and finally compelled him to turn. Hewson half turned and then swung his chair so as to bring him face to face with those dreadful hypnotic eyes. Hewson's own eyes were dilated and his mouth lifted at the corners in a snarl. And then Hewson spoke and woke 100 sinister echoes.
You moved, blast you! Yes, you did, I saw you!
And then he sat quite still, staring straight before him, like a man found frozen in the Arctic snows. Dr. Burdett's movements were leisurely. He stepped off his pedestal with the mincing care of a lady alighting from a bus. He stepped off the platform and sat down on the edge facing Hewson. And then he nodded and smiled and he said, good evening. He spoke in perfect English with only a trace of foreign accent. I need hardly tell you that not until I overheard the conversation between you and the worthy manager of this establishment did I suspect that I should have the pleasure of a companion here for the night. Now, you cannot move or speak without my bidding, but you can hear me perfectly well. Now, something tells me that you are, shall I say, nervous? My dear sir, have no illusions. I am not one of these contemptible effigies miraculously come to life. I am Dr. Burdett himself. Let me explain. Circumstances with which I need not fatigue you have made it desirable that I should live in England. I was close to this building this evening when I saw a policeman regarding me a bit too curiously. So I mingled with the crowd and I came in here, and an inspiration showed me a certain means of escape. I raised a cry of fire, and when all the fools had rushed up the stairs, I stripped my effigy of the caped coat which you behold me wearing. I donned it, I hid my effigy under the platform at the back, and I took its place on the pedestal. I own that I have spent a very fatiguing evening, but fortunately I was not always being watched and had opportunities to draw an occasional deep breath and ease the rigidity of my pose. Oh, one small boy screamed and exclaimed that he saw me moving. I understood that he was to be whipped and put straight to bed on his return home, and I can only hope that the threat has been executed to the letter. I am obliged to the chance which brought us together tonight, and perhaps it would seem ungrateful to complain. From motives of personal safety, my activities have been somewhat curtailed of late years, and I am glad of this opportunity of gratifying my somewhat unusual whim. But you have a skinny neck, sir, if you will overlook a personal remark. I should never have selected you from choice. I like men with thick necks, thick red necks. This, which I have in my hand, is a little French razor. They're not much used in England, but perhaps you know them? Yes. One strops them on wood. The blade, you will observe, is very narrow. They do not cut very deep, but deep enough. In just one little moment, you will see for yourself. Now, my friend, you will have the goodness to raise your chin a little. Thank you. A little more. Just a little more. Ah, thank you. Merci, monsieur. Ah, merci. Merci. In the morning, the sunrise began to mingle with subdued light from the electric bulbs. And this mingled illumination added a certain ghastliness to a scene which needed no additional touch of horror. The waxwork figures stood apathetically in their places. In their midst, on the center gangway, Hewson sat still, leaning far back in his armchair. His chin was up-tilted, as if he were awaiting to receive attention from a barber. And although there was not a scratch upon his throat nor anywhere on his body, he was cold and dead. His previous employers were wrong in having him credited with no imagination. Dr. Burdett, on his pedestal, watched the dead man unemotionally. He didn't move, nor had he moved. After all, how could he? He was only a waxwork.
Good night.